I wanted history to... Let's turn this off. Anyway, it's a song called High School Dropout. History's repeating itself because the last time when we had Mark Bauerlein on the podcast, I started with an endless version of these two high school girls singing the song High School Dropout, which is... Turns out I regretted that. I re-listened to the podcast today and I wanted to kill myself. It lasted for... It seemed like a year. But anyway, I did that mostly just to kid around with Mark Bauerlein from Emory University, who's going to be our guest in a second. First, I want to introduce the great Chris D. sitting to my right.
Hello, hello.
Yes. All right. You feel good? Wait, the High School Dropout's still playing. All right. Now we stop that. Are you doing okay? Everything good?
I'm doing all right.
All right. Good. Recovering from a traumatic day?
traumatic day, traumatic weekend, traumatic everything. Traumatic life, really.
All
but
right.
Let's not get into that.
All right. And then also the great Heather Kay is joining us from the corner. And Heather, whoa.
She looks beautiful.
Oh, no, don't do that. Don't go there. Heather is actually out today, so we just have the empty chair. But we do have Mark Bauerlein coming to us from Emory University. And there he is. Mark, thanks for joining us on today's Reform School program. We appreciate it.
I'm glad to be here.
All right, so I wanted to cover a couple of the main stories in the news. If you look at the Choice Media website, we have the 4 million kids to begin their test of Common Core exams this week, and we'll have a little more on that later. In fact, we've seen that Mark has written some to some extent about Common Core and wanted to show you just a couple things. This is a piece he penned in July of 2013, Common Core versus Great Literature, posing the, I guess, the structure of that title as if there is a choice. Which do you want? Do you want Common Core or Great Literature? And then also this piece was from this month. He writes, Mark Bauerlein writes, why we all have a stake in the Common Core standards. And so we're going to get to a little more of that in a bit, Mark, but tell us, I guess, where you're coming from on these pieces and why do we all have a stake in the Common Core standards?
Well, my position on Common Core is that I think the standards overall have some strengths, and I'm coming at it mostly from high school because I teach in college. I'm at the freshman year for the most part, so I'm seeing students 3 months after they've graduated from high school, and I'm in an English department, and so I get a nice glimpse of what students at a fairly selective institution are doing in their last 3 years, we'll say, of high school reading. And what I find is that their reading is all over the place. There is very little uniformity that you can count on. There's only one book that you can mention that every single student has read so far. It's not the Bible. It is not Huck Finn. It's not The Great Gatsby. It's Harry Potter. this is the common reading, the common book in their lives now. And I think Common Core tries to address that with a few of the standards that do highlight some strong literature. There's one standard for grade 11 and 12 literature reading that has students demonstrate knowledge of foundational works of 18th, 19th, and early 20th century literature. They don't specify what those are. The problem is that when we get to the actual lesson plans and modules that are created, when the curriculum developers get a hold of the standards, and then when the test developers, which is what we're going to get this week, start administering the test, what are we going to see? And in the first article that you mentioned, I noticed that very few of the curriculum materials that I've seen do have a strong literary and just strong classic text component, not
so,
just
so, yeah, so explain how that could be, Mark. You've got, if you say this, you like the standards, but you don't like the curriculum or the various curricula developed around them. Allegedly, the curricula being back-driven by the assessments. Is that the point of view? Is it, how is it that the textbooks aren't so good then? Where did it go wrong?
Right now, until the tests really come out, it's going to be back-driven mostly by the standards, or at least it's supposed to be. But I'll tell you what a leading educator said to me a while back when I mentioned that standard that I just cited about knowledge of foundational works of literature. And I said, how are they going to work those into the curriculum? That sounds like a full year course of American literature. How are they going to work that into the tests? And he said, they won't. They'll just ignore it. So this is the issue here with getting the curricular materials genuinely aligned with the standards and then getting the tests genuinely assessing what appears in the standards. And the fact is, we're going to get people picking and choosing. They're going to go where the strengths are, and the standards are big enough so that you can get pick and choose, and you can be selective, and you can go with what you're already familiar with.
I got to tell you what, this is a very different critique of Common Core than we're used to, because you describe uniformity as a virtue. Many of the Common Core critics consider uniformity something to be avoided, something to be feared, that it actually kills innovation, uniformity. Your critique is that there's just too many people are doing their own thing here, and there's not enough uniformity, right?
Well, I do, and I'm in one of the softer subjects. I'm in English, and I believe that having a core body of knowledge going way back into traditions, and that can go back into English literature all the way back to Shakespeare, it can go back American literature all the way to Ben Franklin and the Puritans, I think that's an important thing,
all right.
And that all students should have it.
All right. Well, let's get to that in a second. We have a couple other stories, and Chris, I wanted to start with the Philadelphia story that you were looking at today, and it has to do with the teacher's contract.
Right. So what comes to your mind, Bob, when I say President Harry Truman?
He dropped the bomb. I know
the
that.
The nuclear bomb?
Yeah.
Well, that's very appropriate, isn't it? Because
okay.
We're talking about the nuclear option going down in Philadelphia right now, which
right.
means that if the district deems it necessary, that the unions will not be able to, the district will continue to operate without the consent of the unions if a deal is not reached.
Right. So this is actually, even the title in Philly.com, the Inquirer coverage, was that the union talks could go nuclear, and nuclear means that the regular school district says, we're going to tell you what to do, teachers union. We're going to stop negotiating and just tell you what to do. And what that could mean is a strike. That's really what it could mean, right?
Possibly.
And so this, you know, some may say this is what, you know, Chicago went through a couple of years ago. The one difference being that Chicago at that time had a presidential election a month away, and maybe there was a reason to end the strike that will not be in play this time when Philadelphia faces one. But both districts have something in common, which is they're broke. And actually in debt. So it says actually $14 million hole to fill this year in terms of the budget there. I don't know, Mark, what do you think of when you see these kinds of contract loggerheads form, and it looks like both sides are just staking positions that are nowhere near each other?
I'm one of those people who is at the point where I don't know enough about the nuts and bolts of this particular case, but there's an exhaustion factor taking place. When we look at the public school system, and all the complexities, the reforms, the corruptions that are taking place. And remember, I'm in Atlanta, where we've had the biggest cheating scandal
sure.
in recent history. We had dozens of people indicted, and it's still in the courts now.
And over 100 teachers involved. Right?
I'm in DeKalb County of Atlanta, which last year the governor took, let's call it the nuclear option, and he suspended school board members because the county was in danger of losing its accreditation, which
right.
mean all those students, and they specifically pointed to dysfunction in the school board, also a lot of conflicts between teachers and administration. So, you know, for me, this it's hard at this point for me to follow these stories so closely. I mean, we're just, again, another one, more conflict, more controversy, more disagreement,
right.
and you know you reach this, that exhaustion factor, and you say, okay.
And you also, is it fair to say that this, you know, am I you know, leading the witness here, or naively, you know, optimistic to assume that, you know, it's funny how I don't see this in the charter and the private schools going on all the time, isn't it? That's kind of weird. Gee, I guess they don't seem to be constant loggerheads about how to deal with their employees and their staff, which the regular district schools are. Is that, you know, am I crazy for assuming that's a better model than the one with these Chicago strikes and potential Philly strikes?
I think it's a better model, and it's not because all charter schools are better than the public schools. What you find is, though, that the charter schools that don't do well disappear more quickly. They are handled with more dispatch. Mm. That there's more flexibility. And so if they fail, then they aren't kept around for very long.
All right.
I think that's the advantage.
Okay. Let's move on. Well, I wanted to talk to you about a racial disparity story. The federal government put out a report that basically said it was all based on data, saying that when it comes to discipline, in fact, there was a big difference between how black and white kids are suspended, the rates per capita at which they're suspended and expelled, et cetera. And we did a little piece on it, and here it is. The Civil Rights Division of the U.S. Department of Education released a new report on racial bias and discipline in schools. It said that black students are suspended at a rate 3 times greater than white students, 16% versus 5%. It also said black students represent 16% of student enrollment, but 27% of the students referred to law enforcement, and 31% of students subjected to a school-related arrest. In comparison, white students are 51% of enrollment, and only 41% of students refer to law enforcement, and 39% arrested. The report did not specifically allege bias or racism, but the implication of such was enough for Manhattan Institute senior fellow Heather McDonald to pen a piece for the National Review called "More Distortion from the Ed Department of Racial Discipline Disparities." She spoke with Choice Media by phone.
The Obama administration is on a crusade to accuse schools of racism based on the fact that black students are disciplined at higher rates than white students. But what the Obama administration and the civil rights advocates refuse to take into account is actual student behavior in the classroom. They simply look at the outcomes. Nobody complains about males. The male-female disparity in suspensions and expulsions is about the same as the black-white disparity, but people accept that males are more unruly. Nobody complains about it, and it's not just culture, Bob. It's also family structure. The family is breaking down across America, but the problem is exponentially worse for black kids, 73% of whom are born to single mothers, compared to about 27% of white kids.
And so, Mark Bauerlein, the argument here is that percentage of outcomes, well, outcomes doesn't equal bias, in other words. And so it does seem like the Obama administration, when you look at Louisiana, how they pushed back against vouchers, alleging that some districts might have, I don't know, a different percentage of white kids took the vouchers than black kids, and that could be something the feds would get involved to correct, as well as another paper, guidelines, actually, they put out a couple months ago. They're looking into this more and more. What are your thoughts on it?
First of all, let's remember that the Office of Civil Rights and the Obama administration is a thoroughly politicized office. We have to take anything coming out of that office with a large grain of salt. Also, simply to give the numbers and leave it there is, of course, an irresponsible action. There has to be some deeper digging into these discrepancies and disproportions in the rates of punishment. And so I'm not sure what to do with this report. I mean, the clear implication that any person on the street would draw from this is either we've got worse behavior among African-American students, or we've got racist teachers and school administrations, or some mixture of the two. What is it? Just giving us these numbers doesn't tell us anything. And again, to put them out there without any interpretation, without any contextualization, again, is irresponsible. It calls for demagoguery. It calls for race baiting of various kinds. It becomes a political football. Yeah. So,
and I'll tell you another point, Mark, we brought up on the Reform School show before, is that some of the black parents may be very happy to get some of the bully black kids out of the school so their nice black kids can learn. And that, in other words, that it's presumed as if there's some sort of, maybe I'm reading too much into this, and, tell me if that's the case, but that it's presumed as if black Americans generally want way fewer suspensions, as if there aren't some really bad kids that need to be taken out of the classroom environment that are really incredibly disruptive, and if they're left in the classroom environment, would keep a lot of other kids from learning. And so I'm convinced there are a lot of black parents that are glad that some of the tougher, rougher black kids are out of the classroom, in other words. And so these kinds of missives from the Civil Rights Division of the U.S. Department of Education seem to forget that.
You know, this is exactly the kind of thing we need in this report. Do we have interviews with parents? Do we have interviews with other students? And I mean the parents of children who are suspended, as well as the parents of other kids in that school.
Yeah, I mean,
do we have qualitative inquiry going on?
Yeah, where I'm coming from on this is actually if you go to some, in fact, there's a great charter school I went to in the Atlanta area. Where I heard this, but some of these parents love these charter schools. Most of them are heavily black and Latino that I visited, and the parents love the fact that the discipline is really great there, that it's very orderly, that there aren't, you know, fights breaking out every day.
But the question is, are black kids on average getting suspended more than white kids? So it's like, for example, we know in terms of drug offenses, African Americans get arrested more than Caucasians do, even though they consume roughly the same amount of drugs. So in that case, I mean, you can draw a conclusion of racism. In this case, there's simply not enough information. You have to ask, you know, is this because you have, is this a result of bigotry, or is it simply a result of something else? So there really isn't enough information in the article, like he's saying.
Well, and I should think...
I have a question.
Go ahead.
Do we really want to say that people who work in schools with high African-American discipline actions, that those people are racist? Have you gone into schools and met those people? Have you worked in the education world? I frankly find it hard to believe that there is anything, certainly conscious or overt racism going on. This would have to be extremely subtle to get through the environment that makes up these schools.
Yeah. And also imagine, as I've said before too, if the word goes out that our school is harder on black kids than white kids, and that all the kids learn that they've been the school's been disciplined for this, what message does that send to the black and Latino kids that, well, we all know that we actually going to get more of a free pass going forward. And also, like, what does it say, too? We really got to up our suspensions of Asian kids. Boy, that's just, they're getting a free ride, these Asian kids. They're a low rate of suspensions. We got to start expelling them. Find ways to, so that we can prove that we're not racist, I guess you might say. Anyway, let's move on to the Common Core assessments. And so you did a piece on this today?
I did indeed.
4 million students in 36 states will soon be testing new Common Core exams. The Common Core Initiative outlines standards enforced by state governments for K-12 students' proficiency in math and English language arts. Joy Pullman from School Reform News told Choice Media,
given that a couple of states especially have dropped PARC and are going with ACT, and that we've heard some kind of rumblings about maybe College Board getting in the K-12 assessment business, there's definitely a little bit of competition, right? And you need those testing consortia have to hang on to so many states in order to make the money work. Otherwise, you know, the scale that they're providing, you know, they have to increase the price per student, which makes it more likely that states will drop out. So it's a very tricky balance that they have.
These states will be conducting field tests in which students will sit down in front of computers and answer questions that are designed to promote critical thinking skills. Researchers hope to answer questions such as, are exams too hard or not hard enough? And do students tend to score better using a computer than they do with pencils and paper? This comes at a time when Common Core is still dealing with resistance from several states, including Indiana and Tennessee. But proponents are confident and hope that the field test will iron out any problems that may arise. Joe Wilhoft of the Smarter Balanced Assessment Consortium told reporters, "We have a saying in Smarter Balanced that if nothing goes wrong in the field test, then actually we have failed." Of course, not everyone shares that sense of optimism.
But the thing that I am interested that was likely to come out, at least from the school's perspective, is just kind of the technical aspects of, can schools run these tests, right? Can they run? Do they have the computers? Do they have the bandwidth? Will they see? I mean, will they have kids getting kicked off? Will they have test results being invalidated?
So maybe, though, that testing it is exactly what he's that what's happening this week is what he's calling for, right? Mm-hmm. The lieutenant governor of North Carolina. So maybe he's happy with this week's test.
Perhaps.
But I guess the question is another point that Joy Pullman made to us, Mark, is that, in fact, we may have no idea what happens this week because SBAC and PARC are not government entities in the sense that they can get Freedom of Information Act requests, and there's nothing that will make them share the results of this week's 4 million kids taking Common Core tests. There's nothing that's going to make them share this. So we may actually learn nothing from this, but you know, except for the possibility of just word leaking out, if teachers happen to talk to newspapers in certain schools where these tests were given, and we learn stuff that way. But what do you expect this week?
The testing, all the testing firms hold their materials very, very closely. And the issues surrounding them regarding bias, confidentiality, making sure that all the technology is in place, and when you think all the money that's involved, make this such a delicate and tense process. And it's for PARC and Smarter Balanced, too. They are trying very hard to come up with a good product, a good assessment, and they want to try to fulfill the mandate of Common Core. So I think that the comparison, say, to the drug being tested, they're doing the best they can, and we can't do this with education curriculum and assessments the same way we would with the testing of drugs. But what I would like to know is precisely what everyone wants to know. What's on the tests? I want to see the exact questions. I want to see the passages that are on there, because that is going to have a retroactive impact on what's taught in the classroom. It'll have a greater effect than the standards themselves. Look, we had the SAT revised, a new rollout. It won't happen for a few years, but the SAT has said that they are going to, David Coleman has said, they're going to include either one of the founding documents, the Declaration or the Constitution, the Gettysburg Address, one of those materials, on the test, or something related to them. Well, this ensures that teachers in 10th and 11th and 12th grade, somewhere along the line, every school is going to make sure students are exposed to those materials. That fear of the SAT is going to mean a whole lot more than any call for patriotism or historical knowledge or producing better citizens. If it's on the test, it'll be in the classroom. So I want to know what's there. I would like to see, tell us what materials are going to be on the test so that we can teach those materials.
Some would hate you for saying that. They're like, you're advocating teaching to the test, and therefore you are eliminating creativity from the classroom.
I'm advocating teaching the test as long as we have good tests.
Okay.
Good materials on those tests.
Ladies and gentlemen, his passion is palpable. He is Mark Bauerlein, English professor at Emory University, and he is particularly looking intelligent today because of all the books behind his head. Our thanks to Mark Bauerlein of the Core Knowledge blog. It's at coreknowledge.org is where you can find his information. And Mark, thank you for being a part of today's Reform School program. We appreciate it.
Thank you.
All right. And for Chris and for the folks in the back, like Allison and John, and not for Heather, because Heather has contributed nothing to today's program, my name is Bob Bowden, and we'll see you next time.